I'm back. I've had breakfast. You might need your fast twitch muscles going. I was accused at morning tea of being a scientist. Mark Lintman's accused me of doing too much replication last night. Bunch of co-authors on this study, and I want to thank Murray-Darling Basin Authority for funding this work. It's complicated. I've got a lot of slides to get through. I'm going to try and move fast, but keep you coming with me. So the broad scale stuff is that this we undertook development of a bunch of population models for a bunch of species in the basin. And so this particular talk is going to focus on golden perch. The underlying driver for doing all this work is to look at population dynamics in response to flow. So I hear you asking me, how do you create a population model? Well, I'm going to tell you. And you've seen it a bit earlier. So we examine the life history of the species. We collect data relevant to the life history where possible. And we establish impacts and threats where they occur in the life history. And so and we try and quantify those impacts. So in particular, we're going to be looking at how flow influences the life history. And then we assemble all this information in our model. So golden perch, again, are a long-lived fish species. They grow relatively quickly. Again, exhibit variable egg production, so variable fecundity, up to over 500,000 eggs. Sexually mature by 3 years of age, large-scale movement, flow-dependent spawner, and then also eggs and larvae drift in the flow. So there's a bunch of elements to the life history here dependent upon flow. Again, we look at the life cycle analysis, and we identify four stages of development for golden perch: eggs, larvae, juveniles, and adults. Adults produce eggs. And so we're looking at interference, if you like, to different aspects of this life cycle as to how flow pushes certain components, certain stages of golden perch. And so we convert this into an age-based model. And so, as you heard me talk earlier, recruitment is a process of eggs hatching into larvae surviving to fingerlings, young of year, to one-year-olds. One-year-olds survive to become two-year-olds. Two-year-olds survive to become adults. Once you're an adult forever. The model. As you heard earlier, recruitment in the top row and survival in the diagonal. In this case, we have a 30 age class for golden perch. So the model construct requires us to estimate these population parameters, in particular survival and fecundity rates. And then we've got to look at how we derive those age-specific survival rates from age data, and then fecundity from known weight fecundity relationships. As you saw in my previous talk, we've got a bunch of age data, fit a curve to it, come up with some estimates of survival. Again, for a long-lived species, we see that survival increases with age through to the mid-teens and then declines into older ages. So using similar relationship that Stewie Rowland published on in the early 80s for weight fecundity, and then combining weight, length and age data to come up with an age fecundity relationship. So here we have the mean relationship with age and variable fecundity around each given age. So you can see that the average approaches about 400,000 eggs per female, but when you look at the variation, it can be from 200,000 up to 700,000 eggs. So we want to look at golden perch dynamics in the basin. And so we came up with these seven population, we defined seven populations around the basin based upon a variety of characteristics, but in particular flow. And there's the location of these populations, population three being Yarrawonga to Turumbury, in case you can't quite identify that acronym. So to understand the dynamics in the basin, we had to examine a lot of flow data, daily flow data and daily temperature data at each location. And we've got age-specific survival rates and fecundity. And we've got estimates of early life history survival rates, egg, larvae, fingerling survival from hatchery data. And then we want to look at how flows influence different aspects of the life history. And then we also develop some special rules for how the dynamics occur in and around Menindee Lakes. So each population has a bunch of relationships for flow temperature, spawning, survival, eggs and larvae, productivity, egg and larval drift, one-year-old, two-year-old movement, spawning and adult movement. And then for Menindee Lakes, we've got productivity, larval drift and fingerling movement into the lakes, and then 1 and 2 year old movement out of the lakes. So an example of some of the rules. So in the southern connected basin, we specify that for spawning to occur, you need 2 days of 19 degrees and then an increase in flow, but that the spawning occurs on the declining limb of that flow. And then in particular in the lower Murray, you need a flowing environment. So under 20,000 megalitres a day, the lower Murray isn't a flowing environment. It's a series of pools. And then as the flow increases over 20,000 megalitres a day, you get a flowing environment occurring in the lower Murray. So we've got a framework now to look at different elements of the life history, and we can characterise this by risk. We can talk about probability of persistence, and we can rank management options through this framework. So let's see how this is all put together. Now, Brenton asked me to put up a slide of what it's like inside my brain, and here it is. And I want to talk about this particular... No, I don't. Sorry. So we developed some software to look at, to run this model and to run thousands of iterations. And it's got a nice graphical user interface and allows us to examine all sorts of different scenarios. So here's the output of one single run from the model for the greater metal population of the basin. And so if we add some environmental variation, descriptions of environmental variation and variation amongst individuals. So if we run this model again, we get a bunch of different outputs. So here's 10 trajectories from the model. Here's 20. There's a couple of hundred. You can start to see patterns starting to build up here, but there is some variation in amongst each individual trajectory. So here's the summary from all 1,000 trajectories. So the black line is the average population size through time. The blue line is indicative of variation around the average, and the red lines are maxima and minima. We see that during the millennium drought, we've got this decline in the population size and then a recovery post the breaking of the drought. The variation in all those different trajectories allows me to look at I can collect information on the minimum population size from each trajectory and put this into a probability distribution, a risk curve. And so we can talk about the probability of the population being less than 1.5 million is about 0.5. And this is important in terms of we might want to specify a level that we don't want the population to fall below. And we'll talk about this a bit more later. So we can look at all the individual population dynamics. So Lower Murray, Northern Basin, different scales here in terms of population size. You'll see that this the Mid-Darling is mainly fed by movement down from the Northern Basin, and so that's why that's reflecting less flow dynamics than the other populations. Thanks, mate. If we add fishing into this, then, and we're not putting in large amounts, but some probability of capture in the different locations in a slightly higher level at Yarrawonga Turumbury, because we know that experiences a higher level of angling. And so our probability risk curve from before, if we throw in angling, we see that the probability risk curve pushes to the left, and we call this added risk. We can quantify it by undertaking some simple analysis, and it's about 50% decline in our risk curve, or 50% shift. If we change fishing to being zero in the Lower Murray, and we look at Yarrawonga, so everything else is the same, just turned off fishing in the Lower Murray, and we look at the Yarrawonga to Turumbury reach or population. So this is not focusing on the Lower Murray, although that's where we've turned fishing off. So here's the risk curve for Yarrawonga to Turumbury. This is when we turn fishing off in the Lower Murray, and so we've decreased risk. But we haven't done anything in Yarrawonga to Turumbury. So this is showing the connectivity of these populations and how different management affects different in one location affects population dynamics in another location. What happens if we turn off Menindee Lakes? I should say, what happens if we disconnect Menindee Lakes? So in the Northern Basin, we see a long-term decline. In the Lower Murray, we still see flow response to for golden perch dynamics in response to flow. But in the risk curves, we see this dramatic shift to the left. So certainly changing how the movement dynamics around Menindee affects both the Northern Basin and the Southern Basin. So in conclusion, flows and connectivity are important for golden perch. A significant decline in flows in the Northern Basin will impact on golden perch in the Southern Basin. Operation of Menindee Lakes influences all the basin. The metapopulation model allows us to test key assumptions. Fishing impacts vary around the basin, and local fishing levels may influence other populations. We can't resile from this fact. Flow and angling impacts need to be considered together. They both influence population dynamics. Complex combination of threats and flow management can be methodically examined in this framework. Outcomes can be ranked for clear evidence-based decision making, and golden perch, so the final point is that golden perch need a coordinated basin scale management. Bunch of co-authors that I'd like to thank. Special thanks to NWBA, and in particular, Helena Bamford and Stu Little, and thanks to steering committee members, Tony Townsend, Peter Jackson, and also a bunch of people who attended workshops who gave information to us freely that helped me construct this model. Thank you very much.